Hey everybody, Clay Archer, CEO DPC Technology. Today we're going to take the new Ubiquiti Display Cast, we're going to do a quick review of it, and then we're going to compare it to the other digital signage products that we use here at DPC Technology. As you may have seen in our previous videos, we use Raspberry Pis with piSignage, and we also use USB sticks behind smart TVs. So today we're going to dive in and do a quick review of the Display Cast, but stick around to the end because we're going to compare it to the other products that we use and see how it stacks up and if it's the right product for you. So without any further mumbling, let's jump right in and get the Display Cast installed. So you'll see that I am installing it here on our Cloud Key Gen 2 Plus. You're going to need a device, and obviously this is probably my first dig against the system, is you are going to need a controller of some sort. Let's go ahead and jump into the Cloud Key Gen 2 Plus, and we will, you can see here it is not set up. We're going to go ahead and click Setup on Connect. I've already got the Connect Cast plugged in behind the TV, and it is on the network via PoE, so I'm going to go ahead and click that and go next, and you're going to see it found it right off the bat. Now, it has got a crazy name, so I will call this DPC Knock 1. This will eventually be a screen in our Knock that we put the core value winner of the week up each week. This is something that we traditionally did with our Raspberry Pi and piSignage. So I'm not going to set it up to a group because it's the only one here for now, and I'm going to go Adopt. And it really was that quick and easy. You can see it just showed up. It is blinking orange here, which I am assuming is gonna mean it's adopting. Okay, let's go ahead and click it there to update. As you can see, after maybe a 4 or 5 minute update, it updated and it is now up and online. So I'm gonna take a couple of minutes, I'm gonna play with it, and I'll jump right back in here and give you guys a once over. All right, so I said I was gonna play with it for a few minutes and then come back, and it's actually been a week. That's pretty typical of these kind of new products where I kind of dive in a little bit, look at it and go, you know, is there more to it? And I want to play with it, wanted to play with scheduling and stuff. So I will say at this point, the product is not super mature. I just kind of wanted to test it. I wanted to test its scheduling and put it through its paces. But here you see the main screen here, and I can click on the Display Cast. It can show you what we're displaying at the moment. Just give some basic information of it, some basic settings. You can see the device name, the group it's in, the mode, and I think this is one of the more significant things here is this mode setting. Obviously, I think because it has this drop down, they're planning on having more than one mode here. I'm hoping that at some point that it'll be able to do the functions of a viewport, but at this point it just has digital signage as the only mode that it has. I'm gonna point out this assigned playlist. This is the only spot where you see assigned playlists and can design playlists. And playlists are kind of an important thing for your scheduling. So we'll come back to that in a minute. Moving on, there's locate device, which is nice. If you have 5 or 6 of these and you're trying to figure out which one is which, you can click this and it comes up on the screen. You can restart the device and forget the device. You also can update the device. Pretty simple here, pretty straightforward, nothing earth-shattering here, but I will once again say playlists are underneath all devices. You can also get groups here, you can click under groups. Settings here, very similar, to give you an overview, it says what scene's being displayed at the moment, which displays are in this group, what their modes are, the schedule, which schedules that they have. That's one schedule event, I can click there and go to the schedule. The devices that are in this group, add and remove those devices, and settings here. Again, scenes, I could add or remove scenes and delete the group altogether. So here's kind of the long and short of it. If we go to the gear here and we go to media, there are really three things that we're dealing with. There's the media itself, and you upload the media. You can add that media to a playlist, and you can add those playlists to a scene. That was kind of the more difficult part of figuring it all out. It's not really well stated in the manual, but I'm gonna walk through really quickly how I would design a scene and how I could schedule that scene. So that the base level is media. I've uploaded a bunch of media here. Hover over upload media here. You can see the media that it will use. Right now you get MP4s, MP3s, JPEGs, and PNGs. It's not a lot of file formats that you can use here. But from those, you just click the upload button and find the file on your computer and upload it. I've done quite a few here. Uploaded at a reasonable amount of time. I did get one that hung on me and I had to reset the Display Cast. I don't know whether it was just a coincidence or not, but for the most part, I uploaded all these, did not have much trouble. Even the bigger, you know, what's the biggest one that I've got here? 518 megabytes, it loaded fine, no problems. Maybe took 3 or 4 minutes to upload. If I click on preview, It'll show you what that video is, plays it here locally. It also can play it on the display. And pretty simple, no big deal. So you can sort it all there. You can sort by name, you can sort by type. That's, you know, pretty easy. Once I've got my media upload, I'll go to a playlist and I'll just create a new playlist. And we'll call this test. And I will go add slides, it calls them slides, and I'll just say we're gonna do Daniel, we'll do December, we'll do Donovan Karate, and we'll do DW. Go add. And so once I've got the playlist built, I'll just go create, and it will be another one in here in my list. So if I wanna create a scene, I'm gonna go to groups, I'm gonna go to settings, I'm going to scenes, and I'm gonna go create scene. And it's just gonna create a scene based off of what I got now, which is this rolling four pictures of the guys and Tina. And I would rename this to, I don't know, we'll just call this test as well. So now I've got another scene. Once I'm done with that, I'm gonna click create. And boom, now I've got this scene called test. And I can choose that now from my schedule. And so I'm gonna go back in here and I'm gonna do that again. I'm gonna create a task. I'm gonna go say, let's do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. This time, I'm gonna go edit. I'm gonna go group is knock, scene is test. And then when I'm done, it says start time. It's gonna, so at 2 o'clock, it's gonna turn to test. And when it's done, I'm gonna go back to daily display and go done. So now every day at 2 o'clock on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, sorry, it's going to go to that. There's some other neat things in here that you can see. So one of the other things that you're able to do with that is if you just wanted the display cast to go to off. So you can see if I go into, go to devices here and displays, I can go power off. So if I click on power off here, now this device is gonna just turn to off during that time frame, and I would create that scene. So or I would save it as that scene. So anyways, a little bit cryptic, but that's the way you're able to create a scene so that that displays on certain screens at a certain time. I will say that in piSignage, it is kind of cryptic as well to find from a scene to a playlist to a media and kind of understanding what all three of them are. So that is honestly going through this, that is it. There's nothing in here that's earth shattering. There, you know, I spent some time here to see, you know, go as deep as I could on it to find if there's some hidden way that I could do different transitions or do some kind of fancier stuff. The reality of it is it's just that basic. So basically what it's able to do at this point is static images, JPEGs, PNGs, and videos, MP4s. So basically if you, if that's what you're after, if you're a surf shop and you want to just display a surfing scene on a roll, you're able to do that. It has 16 gigs of internal storage. I didn't try and hit that buffer. I threw maybe 2 or 3 gigs of stuff at it and it was totally fine. Another thing about it is it's a little jarring on the transitions. It doesn't have transitions. So overall, as a unit itself, I think it's pretty robust. I do like the fact that it's a black box and that you really can't do much to it. And I do feel like there's a lot of potential here. Whether Ubiquiti does anything with that or not, I'm not quite sure. So that's the review of the product itself in a nutshell. Let's go ahead and compare it to the other products that we use here at DPC Technology. I'm gonna put a little overlay on the screen here to kind of go through these three products. Again, if you have not seen our thumb drive video or our, several of our piSignage videos, the link will be in the description or there'll be a card on the screen right now. But I'm gonna go through the things that I wanted to see in this unit that are either there in other units or things that are in this unit that I wish are in the other units. So first, let's go with Wi-Fi. This device is connected with a Cat5 cable. It does not have the option to do Wi-Fi. Raspberry Pi does have the option to do it either way. And the thumb drives don't have any connectivity to the network. PoE, this is a PoE device that really is quite nice. So the way I have it configured in configured right now is there's one cable into it and one cable out of it. There's a PoE Cat5 cable coming into it from a Unifi switch and the HDMI out to the TV, which works really well. The Raspberry Pi does not have PoE, it needs AC power, and the thumb drive, it's unpowered and it goes right into the back of the TV. Viewport support, this is no on this device as of now. I think that there is the potential. I can tell you that with a drop down on that menu, I think that it is intended that eventually there are gonna be other functions for this this device, and I really think the viewport support would be awesome. It would be really cool to be able to have a timer on that. So let's just say from during the hours that you're open, it is displaying some sort of signage. And then on the hours that you're not open, maybe it's got the viewport up or the ability to go back and forth. I think that is would be a super nice option. You cannot do a viewport on Raspberry Pi, nor can you on the thumb drive. This is a huge one, HTML5 support. It does not have it, so you can't display a web page. So if you just wanted to put the weather up or run a loop of YouTube videos, you're not able to do that. And I do think that this is one of the bigger advantages of piSignage. You have to produce what you're gonna put on this, as opposed to being able to just go out there and grab a YouTube video and put it on loop, or just a web page and put it up there statically. So I think that's a major kind of drawback of this. The thumb drive does not do that as well. Phone app. I do really like the phone app. I didn't go over the phone app here, but the phone app is a cool addition. I will complain, as I do in all my videos, that is another app that I have on my phone from Unify. And I think that's my 7th one that I've got on my phone right now, which is a little ridiculous. I do think that they need to kind of, the same way that they're doing with UID, I think they need to bring everything into one or two apps that is able to do it all. So that's a little bit of a ding, but I do give them a plus for the app. PiSignage does have an app as well, and the thumb drive does not. I do feel like being able to have multiple people controlling the display with their phone is gonna be a nice advantage for it. The need for the controller. Now this is, I think, is a big negative for this device. So, if you do not have anything in the Unifi system right now and you don't have a controller of any type, you are going to be at a major disadvantage, because the cheapest one you can get is going to be the Cloud Key Gen 2 Plus, which is $199. So if you're not already in the Unifi system, you have a big barrier of entry right there. So I don't think this is a signage program that anybody that's not already in Unify's ecosystem will use. The Raspberry Pi does not need a controller, nor does the thumb drive. And this was kind of my criteria, is my clients don't like monthly fees for something that doesn't really need a monthly fee. And so there is no monthly fee for this, which with all of Unify products, or most of the Unify products, I think that's a big advantage. And for Raspberry Pi, there is no fee for up to 2 units. So that's nice as well. If you're going above that with Raspberry Pi, then you do start to get into the PiSignage licensing fees. So that is an issue. There is no monthly fee for using a USB thumb drive and a smart TV. Multiple location support. Now you could technically do this with multiple locations with VPNs for Unify. I'm gonna put a big asterisk there and say, not really. So for most people, this is kind of gonna be a solution that you're gonna do per location. Whereas PiSignage is made from the get-go, it's cloud-based, and you're able to run it in multiple locations without really any issues. The only thing for PiSignage is you only get 2. So if you had 2 locations with 1 monitor, you'd be able to do that. If you're going beyond that, you're gonna start to pay for licensing fees monthly. And the thumb drive does not have the capability to be controlled from multiple locations. The simple interface. One of the reasons that I like Unify and the Unify ecosystem in general is that the interface is pretty nice and it's pretty simple. I liken it to Apple because the interface is easy enough that if you mess around a little bit, you typically can figure out what you're looking for. I said inconclusive here because I do think the interface is decent, but it's a little cryptic at this point, and I don't feel like this software is fully baked. At this point, I would say that it's got the base there, but I think that you probably really would need an instruction manual for it a little bit, and I don't think that they have all the features that they need yet. So I think there's gonna be more development on this product, so I'm gonna give it an inconclusive there. For PiSignage, as I said before in my video there, it is a little bit cryptic and it's hard to kind of understand it, and it takes a little bit of using PiSignage to understand how it works. Now, on the flip side of that, because it is a little bit cryptic, it is super powerful, and once you figure out how to use it, it really can do quite a lot. At this point, I think that the interface of the Unify is a better interface, even in these early stages. Obviously, there's a super easy interface on the thumb drives. You just go in the smart TV and you point to the thumb drive. It doesn't get much simpler than that. I'm gonna put transitions here, but really this is transitions, this is frames, this is kind of the beauty of a more mature signage system. And there's none of it right now in the display cast. When I say transitions, if you go from video to video or image to image, they are just abrupt changes, and the ability just to maybe have a little bit of a bleed or blend in would be nice. Also, frames is an awesome feature that is not here that is in the PiSignage, is the ability to have maybe 3 or 4 windows on the screen. So maybe you have a video in one corner of the screen, you have a ticker down at the bottom, and you have the temperature on the right-hand side of the screen. The ability to do those kind of higher end features are just, they're not available at all on this unit. And I think that there's a long way to go before that you're able to kind of get those. As far as the transitions on the thumb drive, you're able to do that as well. You're not able to do frames on the thumb drive. And that brings us to the last one, which is the cost. This is $199 plus $199 if you don't already have a controller. A Raspberry Pi, I'll put a link down in the description to the Raspberry Pi kit that I recommend there. By the time you put it all together, you're gonna spend about $229. So I just get the whole kit off of Amazon, where you get the memory card and you get a couple of cables and a power adapter and a case and the fan and all that kind of stuff. So I'm gonna go ahead and say $229.99 for that. And a thumb drive for 32 gigs, thumb drive is $4.99. It's next to nothing. So at this point, I really don't know who this device is for. Honestly, if it was me, I would just get a smart TV and put a thumb drive in it. If I'm going to run just a menu or a couple of videos in a loop, I think you're able to do all of that pretty simply for $4.99 and not have to jump into a whole ecosystem. The drawback to the thumb drive is that you have to get behind the TV and pull that out and change the files on it in your computer every time you want to change it. But for the most part with my signage, 90% of the time, you're not changing it very often, maybe once every 3 to 4 or 5 months. And the ability to do that really quickly and easily is probably worth the saving the money. The problem I have here with the display cast is the hardware is nice. I really like the hardware. I think that there's a lot of potential with the hardware. I do like having it being in a black box, meaning that there's not a lot that goes wrong. I actually power cycled it a couple of times. I pulled the power to the PoE switch and then put it back in just to kind of see how it worked. Pretty much kind of self-contained, and I would feel very comfortable with being in a client's office and not ever having really much support to give it at all. That being said, it only does video and it only does JPEGs, and that's a heck of a lot of money for just doing that. I didn't go into some of the other alternatives, and if you are using a signage program, like let's just say a Chromecast or an Apple TV or another device to do signage, leave it down in the descriptions. I know some people are using those to display some Unify stuff as well, and I'd love to hear what you have to say about that. But in conclusion, as much of a Unify homer as I tend to be, I'm confused by this product and I don't really know who it's for. And I think it's quite expensive for what it does. And I probably couldn't recommend it at this point. The other disappointing fact is that I've had this product for 6 months. I thought that maybe during that time frame they would design some of the stuff. I don't think that the code to do some transitions or maybe do a frame or add some more file support, I don't think that that's that difficult for them to do. I know they have the resources to do it, but I don't know how much they really are trying to do that or want to do that. And as always with Unify, sometimes their corporate decisions on their direction is a little bit of a head scratcher. And I think that's kind of stated over and over again in the forums. So that's my review of the display cast and how it currently stacks up to its competitors. And if you're a small business owner in search of a managed service provider to help you with your IT, please reach out to us at www.dpctechnology.com. We'd love to have a conversation. If you have any comments or questions, please leave them down below. As always, hit the like and subscribe button, and we'll see you guys in the next video.